All right, guys, we are back in my garage for another video, and I think a lot of us are starting to miss the plot, especially car guys out there. We're kind of forgetting what the whole point of it all is. If you care about performance, I'm going to present an argument that you should want thin oils to work. We should be rooting for automotive engineers to figure this out, to make it reliable, make it consistent, and give us everything we want, because the benefits of thin oil will give us better performance, give us better reliability, more consistency. All of the things that we're looking for are needed to make thin oils work. And I've seen some of the videos that were posted over the summer about the recent GM recall, where everybody's kind of defaulting to say that the oil was too thin and that's the problem. But if you look at the details, I think you'll realize that it was something completely different. So let's go ahead and argue about it, and hopefully you guys find this video useful. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe, because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. Now, the first thing I want to highlight is the difference between a tolerance and a clearance, because like a lot of you, I always say that oil is based on the tolerances in an engine, but really that's not correct. I had somebody in the comments clarifying, and the fact of the matter is we're more focused on clearances than tolerances. A tolerance is how much a dimension or a feature can vary. So if it's supposed to be an inch long, maybe it's half inch, maybe it's an inch and a half, but every single part won't be exactly an inch long. So that's what the tolerance is. It gives you a little bit of room for variation during manufacturing. Clearance is the actual space or gap between components. And that's really what we're focusing on for most of our conversations. Yes, both of them are very important, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But clearance is one of the main things we're thinking about as far as oil flow, because that gap between components is where the oil is going to flow through the engine to keep it lubricated and safe. Now, why is this important? Well, your oil has a set viscosity, and that's where most of the arguments are, that certain viscosities aren't safe and never will be. Now, if you look at the oil viscosity rating on a modern synthetic oil, you'll see two numbers. The first one is associated with cold viscosity, and the second one is associated with hot viscosity. So cold start, when you first turn the engine on, versus when the engine is at operating temperature. But there are a couple things to keep in mind here. And the first one I like to remind people is the two numbers are on completely separate scales. They are not related to each other at all. So if in theory you had a 20W20 oil where both numbers were the exact same, the oil would still get thinner as it got hotter. So it's not like the oil viscosity wouldn't change at all. No matter what, once you get heat in the oil, it's going to slightly thin out. But the way that they test the cold range versus the hot range is different. So the scales are completely different, and the two numbers can't really be compared. This becomes more important when you consider that the clearances in your engine will change as the temperature changes. So as things get hotter, if the two materials are the same, the clearances will actually get larger. Both components will get bigger and expand, and they will begin to move away from each other and create larger gaps. Now, this changes for a couple different reasons, especially in an engine. One is most mating components aren't the same material. So if you have aluminum turning against steel or plastic pressed up against metal, they're going to expand at different rates, and that will reduce the clearances. Also, there's going to be variation in heat. So for example, your piston is going to heat up a lot faster than the components around it, like the cylinder walls. So in those cases, a lot of times as the car gets hotter and as you create more combustion temperature, the piston is going to expand more, and that's when you can potentially run into tight or no clearance between the piston and the cylinder wall. So this is kind of where the idea of thicker oils being better kind of came from, especially when you're trying to squeeze out performance from an engine, because as things get hotter, in a lot of cases, you're going to create tighter clearances between components, especially on an engine that wasn't designed to handle the extra power and doesn't have the extra cooling and things that you need. Because if it gets too hot and the oil gets too thin, then basically in the highest stress scenarios, you're going to start experiencing metal on metal contact, which can very quickly damage or completely ruin an engine. People also get in the habit of building higher horsepower cars with engines that have looser clearances, so larger clearances that can expand more as they get hot. So if you have an engine that's designed to handle 500 horsepower, it'll probably have tighter clearances than an engine designed to handle 1,000 or 1,500 horsepower, because at that peak power, when it's burning off all of the fuel and air mixtures that are coming into the combustion chamber at whatever elevated RPM you're running, generally speaking, it's going to create more heat in the engine, which needs a little bit more space for those clearances to get tighter. Now, unfortunately, this isn't foolproof, and my favorite example to use, of course, is the BMW S65. This was an engine from BMW that was supposed to be designed for racing. It was put in the M3, something that you can take to track days, and generally speaking, it works well. But it has that one main Achilles heel being the rod bearings. And this is what the rod bearings look like on an S65 with some miles on it. And this is something that should not happen, definitely not on a performance engine. But this engine was designed to run 10W60 oil, which is extremely thick by modern standards, and somehow they're still running into this issue where the clearances aren't correct, so you're getting metal on metal contact between the rod bearings and the crank. And this is scary, especially for a car that's designed to rev over 8,000 RPM. You don't want this to be something that you can experience. So a lot of owners just replace the bearings regularly because they see it as a wear item. Now, that should not be the case, especially with a thick oil, but this kind of helps expose some benefits that come from running thinner oils. The big one, of course, is it reduces your emissions and improves your engine's efficiency. And this is why a lot of people see OEMs moving to thinner oils, because it helps you get better miles per gallon and reduces how much energy is required to move your vehicle. So it basically makes the engine move more freely. But in the same sense, it's also reducing drivetrain losses. So for those of us that care about wheel horsepower and not just claiming horsepower at the crank, you're actually designing an engine to run more efficiently. So even if it makes the same 200, 300 or whatever horsepower, you're going to make more power to the wheels, which actually makes the car perform better. So without adding any extra stress or boost or timing or anything to the engine, all you're doing is reducing your drivetrain losses, similar to how you would run lighter wheels or a lighter drive shaft. That will help reduce drivetrain losses so that your car can accelerate more quickly, even making the same amount of power. But another big one, of course, is just from a safety standpoint, because when the engine is cold, a thinner oil is going to flow more freely. You're going to build up oil pressure more quickly, and that's going to make sure that it gets to those critical components to protect your engine. And that's why a lot of people like running a 0W on that first number, because that gives you the most cold start protection, and something that even when it gets to really cold and freezing temperatures, you're going to have as much oil protection as possible, because the oil will flow as quickly as possible to your critical components. That's really when it's the most sensitive, when you do that cold start, because at most you're going to have a thin oil film on all of the components. So you want to quickly build up that oil pressure to get between your bearings and all of the other mating components to prevent that metal on metal contact. It also helps make sure that anything that's controlled by oil pressure is activated as quickly as possible. So mostly what we talk about on here are BMWs, and Vanos is a great example that requires oil pressure to modify your cam timing. So if you want a smooth running engine, you need oil pressure to get that. The newer cars move to an electronic Vanos system, so they don't have to wait for oil pressure to build up to give you a smooth start. But on older cars, that's obviously still a thing, basically what most of us own. So you really want that oil pressure to build up and get to the Vanos control unit as quickly as possible to smooth out your idle and get the engine running as smoothly as possible. So if we know that the engine can still get damaged from running really thick oils, and we know that thin oils have all of these potential performance and comfort benefits, how can we make it work? Well, the main thing is, of course, you need to design the engine right, and you need to build it right. And that's kind of the biggest issue that we see with this GM recall. If the engine was designed right, it definitely wasn't built right, because the clearances weren't appropriate for the oil that they were using, and that's what created the engine failures. And I want to link an Engineering Explained video in the video description, because he goes over this really well. So if you need more convincing after watching this, go check out his video. He really breaks down the whole GM recall and the root cause of it. But like a lot of cars, everything isn't made perfectly. Even if it's designed with the best intent and everything should work in theory, if it's not made properly, you'll run into issues. So if the supplier for their rod bearings or their crankshafts or whatever the component is did not build their parts correctly, either built them too large or something that messed up the actual clearances in the engine, that can create failures, even though the oil weight is something that would work by design. And so that's really the problem that they're facing. And what they ended up doing is telling people, if you're not having issues yet, run a thicker oil just in case. Or if you have to get a new engine, then you're fine running the thinner oil because the new engines are being built properly. So that's kind of the first step. You need to design the engine to work with the thinner oil and then build it properly. Now, some of the ways that they design an engine to use thinner oils is making an engine that runs a more consistent temperature. So now you don't have to worry about as much variation in the clearances, and a thinner oil will still be adequate even when the engine gets up to operating temperature. So a great example on modern BMWs, most of our cars have at least 3 or 4 radiators up front, and that's cooling everything down to keep it at operating temperature. Even when I'm on track, you guys have seen my videos, and I have pretty much no issues with cooling. The cars are extremely efficient from a cooling standpoint, so that's something that a lot of OEMs are moving to, adding additional radiators and larger radiators to help the car have just a higher cooling capacity so they don't have to compensate for really high temps. Then there are other things like our redesigned thermostat. I've talked about that in my previous video where I talked about max cooling mode and the settings on our car to reduce engine temperatures. On a BMW, our heat management module allows the car to get up to temperature quickly. So now you're minimizing the amount of time that it's actually in that super high viscosity state when it's cold to make sure that the car gets up to temperature and stays at temperature as long as possible. So now majority of the time, the car is actually staying in that range where it's going to be hopefully as safe and consistent as possible based on the engine oil you're using. So again, just kind of crunching down that range that you really need to worry about. Even things like the coolant flow design inside of the engine will help keep it more consistent. BMW uses a cross flow design on the cylinder head, which basically means coolant comes up from the exhaust side and flows over to the cooler intake side before returning back to the radiator. And what this does is it gives you a more even and consistent temperature across the cylinder head. So now you're less likely to have hot spots or different ranges of heat across the cylinder head. So it'll all be more consistent. And of course, we're seeing more and more coated components coming in from the factory. On BMWs, we have coated cylinder walls, we have coated rod bearings, and these are things a lot of people upgrade to when they're building their engines, but now we have stuff coming from the factory. And I'll say the B58 rod bearings are probably one of the best out there. People put hundreds of thousands of miles on their car, and there's absolutely no signs of wear. That coating is extremely good. So that paired with a thin oil can give you the lubrication that you're looking for to make sure that all of the components are protected while still allowing you to get the benefits and efficiency that comes with a thin oil. So ultimately, what do you want? I would say that you want to run the thinnest adequate oil for your engine. And this is going to be a wide range, especially again on the B58 and other BMW platforms. I think a lot of people have demonstrated that a lot of different oils work. So if you want the car to be as fast as possible and as safe as possible, my recommendation is to get your own data, do an oil analysis, see if there's any excessive wear, make sure that your oil change intervals are adequate, and make sure that you're using the right oil. That data from companies like Blackstone will give you a much better peace of mind versus just trusting people's recommendations on the internet that don't have any data to their name. I just hate when people say, I don't trust it, I don't believe it, this can never work, when in reality, there are reasons why you can make this work. As an engineer, that's your problem. You're not just saying what does and doesn't work. What you should be doing is trying to figure out how to get what you want to work in the real world. So get some data, figure out for yourself that the right oil weight and the right oil change interval and everything that you're doing from an oil standpoint is adequate for your engine, and just stick with what works. That's my recommendation to everybody. But besides that, I definitely agree and believe that we should all be rooting for thinner oils. Hopefully, OEMs continue to get this to a better position where all of us can take advantage of it. And I think nothing but good can come with it if it's designed right and manufactured right. So those are kind of all my thoughts on this. Hopefully I convinced you. If not, you know, let's argue. I'm always welcoming a good conversation, but I think that's it for this video. So thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.